Ascent Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Database Internals, a deep dive into how distributed data systems work. First edition. By Alex Petrov. Narrated by Mike Chamberlain. Publisher's note. This audiobook has bonus material. Please contact whomever you purchased this audiobook from to request the material. All figures and code referenced in this audiobook can be found in the bonus material. The views expressed in this work are those of the author and do not represent the publisher's views. While the publisher and the author have used good faith efforts to ensure that the information and instructions contained in this work are accurate, the publisher and the author disclaim all responsibility for errors or omissions, including, without limitation, responsibility for damages resulting from the use of or reliance on this work. Use of the information and instructions contained in this work is at your own risk. If any code samples or other technology this work contains or describes is subject to open source licenses or the intellectual property rights of others, it is your responsibility to ensure that your use thereof complies with such licenses and/or rights. Preface. Distributed database systems are an integral part of most businesses and the vast majority of software applications. These applications provide logic and a user interface, while database systems take care of data integrity, consistency, and redundancy. Back in 2000, if you were to choose a database, you would have just a few options, and most of them would be within the realm of relational databases, so differences between them would be relatively small. Of course, this does not mean that all databases were completely the same, but their functionality and use cases were very similar. Some of these databases have focused on horizontal scaling out, improving performance and increasing capacity by running multiple database instances acting as a single logical unit. Gamma Database Machine Project, Teradata, GreenPlum, Parallel DB2, and many others. Today, horizontal scaling remains one of the most important properties that customers expect from databases. This can be explained by the rising popularity of cloud-based services. It is often easier to spin up a new instance and add it to the cluster than scaling vertically, scaling up, by moving the database to a larger, more powerful machine. Migrations can be long and painful, potentially incurring downtime. Around 2010, a new class of eventually consistent databases started appearing, and terms such as NoSQL and later big data grew in popularity. Over the last 15 years, the open source community, large internet companies, and database vendors have created so many databases and tools that it's easy to get lost trying to understand use cases, details, and specifics. The Dynamo paper, published by the team at Amazon in 2007, had so much impact on the database community that within a short period, it inspired many variants and implementations. The most prominent of them were Apache Cassandra, created at Facebook, Project Voldemort, created at LinkedIn, and React, created by former Akamai engineers. Today, the field is changing again. After the time of key-value stores, NoSQL, and eventual consistency, we have started seeing more scalable and performant databases, able to execute complex queries with stronger consistency guarantees. Audience of this book. In conversations at technical conferences, I often hear the same question. How can I learn more about database internals? I don't even know where to start. Most of the books on database systems do not go into details of storage engine implementation and cover the access methods, such as B-trees, on a rather high level. There are very few books that cover more recent concepts, such as different B-tree variants and log-structured storage, so I usually recommend reading papers. Everyone who reads papers knows that it's not that easy. You often lack context. The wording might be ambiguous. There's little or no connection between papers, and they're hard to find. This book contains concise summaries of important database systems concepts and can serve as a guide for those who'd like to dig in deeper, or as a cheat sheet for those already familiar with these concepts. Not everyone wants to become a database developer, but this book will help people who build software that uses database systems, software developers, reliability engineers, architects, and engineering managers. If your company depends on any infrastructure component, be it a database, a messaging queue, a container platform, or a task scheduler, you have to read the project change logs and mailing lists to stay in touch with the community and be up to date with the most recent happenings in the project. Understanding terminology and knowing what's inside will enable you to yield more information from these sources and use your tools more productively to troubleshoot, identify, and avoid potential risks and bottlenecks. Having an overview and a general understanding of how database systems work will help in case something goes wrong. Using this knowledge, you'll be able to form a hypothesis, validate it, find the root cause, and present it to other project maintainers. This book is also for curious minds, for the people who like learning things without immediate necessity, those who spend their free time hacking on something fun, creating compilers, writing homegrown operating systems, text editors, computer games, learning programming languages, and absorbing new information. The listener is assumed to have some experience with developing back-end systems and working with database systems as a user. Having some prior knowledge of different data structures will help to digest material faster. Why should I read this book? We often hear people describing database systems in terms of the concepts and algorithms they implement. This database uses gossip for membership propagation. They have implemented Dynamo, or this is just like what they've described in the Spanner paper. Or if you're discussing the algorithms and data structures, you can hear something like, Zab and Raft have a lot in common. BW trees are like the B trees implemented on top of log-structured storage. Or, they are using sibling pointers like in Blink trees. We need abstractions to discuss complex concepts, and we can't have a discussion about terminology every time we start a conversation. Having shortcuts in the form of common language helps us to move our attention to other, higher-level problems. One of the advantages of learning the fundamental concepts, proofs, and algorithms is that they never grow old. Of course, there will always be new ones, but new algorithms are often created after finding a flaw or room for improvement in a classical one. Knowing the history helps to understand differences and motivation better. Learning about these things is inspiring. You see a variety of algorithms, see how our industry was solving one problem after the other, and get to appreciate that work. At the same time, learning is rewarding. You can almost feel how multiple puzzle pieces move together in your mind to form a full picture that you will always be able to share with others. Scope of this book. This is neither a book about relational database management systems, nor about NoSQL ones, but about the algorithms and concepts used in all kinds of database systems, with a focus on storage engine and the components responsible for distribution. Some concepts, such as query planning, query optimization, scheduling, the relational model, and a few others, are already covered in several great textbooks on database systems. Some of these concepts are usually described from the user's perspective, but this book concentrates on the internals. You can find some pointers to useful literature in the Part 2 conclusion and in the chapter summaries. In these books, you're likely to find answers to many database-related questions you might have. Query languages aren't discussed, since there's no single common language among the database systems mentioned in this book. To collect material for this book, I studied over 15 books, more than 300 papers, countless blog posts, source code, and the documentation for several open source databases. The rule of thumb for whether or not to include a particular concept in the book was the question, do the people in the database industry and research circles talk about this concept? If the answer was yes, I added the concept to the long list of things to discuss. Structure of this book. There are some examples of extensible databases with pluggable components, but they are rather rare. At the same time, there are plenty of examples where databases use pluggable storage. Similarly, we rarely hear database vendors talking about query execution, while they are very eager to discuss the ways their databases preserve consistency. The most significant distinctions between database systems are concentrated around two aspects: how they store and how they distribute the data. Other subsystems can at times also be of importance, but are not covered here. The book is arranged into parts that discuss the subsystems and components responsible for storage, Part 1, and distribution, Part 2. Part 1 discusses node local processes and focuses on the storage engine, the central component of the database system, and one of the most significant distinctive factors. First, we start with the architecture of a database management system and present several ways to classify database systems based on the primary storage medium and layout. We continue with storage structures and try to understand how disk-based structures are different from in-memory ones, introduce B-trees, and cover algorithms for efficiently maintaining B-tree structures on disk, including serialization, page layout, and on-disk representations. Later, we discuss multiple variants to illustrate the power of this concept and the diversity of data structures influenced and inspired by B-trees. Last, we discuss several variants of log-structured storage, commonly used for implementing file and storage systems, motivation, and reasons to use them. Part 2 is about how to organize multiple nodes into a database cluster. We start with the importance of understanding the theoretical concepts for building fault-tolerant distributed systems, how distributed systems are different from single-node applications, and which problems, constraints, and complications we face in a distributed environment. After that, we dive deep into distributed algorithms. Here, we start with algorithms for failure detection, helping to improve performance and stability by noticing and reporting failures and avoiding the failed nodes. Since many algorithms discussed later in the book rely on understanding the concept of leadership, we introduce several algorithms for leader election and discuss their suitability. As one of the most difficult things in distributed systems is achieving data consistency, we discuss concepts of replication, followed by consistency models, possible divergence between replicas, and eventual consistency. Since eventually consistent systems sometimes rely on anti-entropy for convergence and gossip for data dissemination, we discuss several anti-entropy and gossip approaches. Finally, we discuss logical consistency in the context of database transactions and finish with consensus algorithms. After each chapter, you will find a summary section that contains material for further study related to the content of the chapter. Conventions used in this book. The following typographical conventions are used in this book. Constant width, used for program listings, as well as within paragraphs to refer to program elements such as variable or function names, databases, data types, environment variables, statements, and keywords. Tips. This element signifies a tip or suggestion. Notes. This element signifies a general note. Warning. This element indicates a warning or caution. Using code examples. This book is here to help you get your job done. In general, if example code is offered with this book, You may use it in your programs and documentation. You do not need to contact us for permission unless you're reproducing a significant portion of the code. For example, writing a program that uses several chunks of code from this book does not require permission. Selling or distributing a CD-ROM of examples from O'Reilly Books does require permission. Answering a question by citing this book and quoting example code does not require permission. Incorporating a significant amount of example code from this book into your product's documentation does require permission. We appreciate but do not require attribution. An attribution usually includes the title, author, publisher, and ISBN. For example, Database Internals by Alex Petrov, O'Reilly. Copyright 2019, Alexander Petrov. 978-1-492-04034-7. If you feel your use of code examples falls outside fair use or the permission given previously, feel free to contact us at permissions@O'Reilly.com. O'Reilly Online Learning. For almost 40 years, O'Reilly Media has provided technology and business training, knowledge, and insight to help companies succeed. Our unique network of experts and innovators share their knowledge and expertise through books, articles, conferences, and our online learning platform. O'Reilly's online learning platform gives you on-demand access to live training courses, in-depth learning paths, interactive coding environments, and a vast collection of text and video from O'Reilly and 200-plus other publishers. For more information, please visit O'Reilly.com. How to contact us? Please address comments and questions concerning this book to the publisher. O'Reilly Media, Inc., 1005 Gravenstein Highway, North Sebastopol, California, 95472. 800-998-9938 in the United States or Canada. 707-829-0515, international or local. 707-829-0104, fax. We have a webpage for this book where we list errata, examples, and any additional information. You can access this page at bit.ly/database-internals. To comment or ask technical questions about this book, please send an email to bookquestions@O'Reilly.com. For more information about our books, courses, conferences, and news, see our website at O'Reilly.com. Find us on Facebook, facebook.com/O'Reilly. Follow us on Twitter, twitter.com/O'Reilly Media. Watch us on YouTube, youtube.com/O'Reilly Media. Part 1. Storage Engines. The primary job of any database management system is reliably storing data and making it available for users. We use databases as a primary source of data, helping us to share it between the different parts of our applications. Instead of finding a way to store and retrieve information and inventing a new way to organize data every time we create a new app, we use databases. This way, we can concentrate on application logic instead of infrastructure. Since the term Database Management System, DBMS, is quite bulky, throughout this book we use more compact terms, database system and database, to refer to the same concept. Databases are modular systems and consist of multiple parts: a transport layer accepting requests, a query processor determining the most efficient way to run queries, an execution engine carrying out the operations, and a storage engine. The storage engine, or database engine, is a software component of a database management system responsible for storing, retrieving, and managing data in memory and on disk, designed to capture a persistent, long-term memory of each node. While databases can respond to complex queries, storage engines look at the data more granularly and offer a simple data manipulation API, allowing users to create, update, delete, and retrieve records. One way to look at this is that database management systems are applications built on top of storage engines, offering a schema, a query language, indexing, transactions, and many other useful features. For flexibility, both keys and values can be arbitrary sequences of bytes with no prescribed form. Their sorting and representation semantics are defined in higher-level subsystems. For example, you can use int 32, 32-bit integer, as a key in one of the tables, and ASCII, ASCII string, in the other. From the storage engine perspective, both keys are just serialized entries. Storage engines such as BerkeleyDB, LevelDB, and its descendant RocksDB, LMDB and its descendant libmdbx, Sophia, HaloDB, and many others were developed independently from database management systems they're now embedded into. Using pluggable storage engines has enabled database developers to bootstrap database systems using existing storage engines and concentrate on the other subsystems. At the same time, clear separation between database system components opens up an opportunity to switch between different engines, potentially better suited for particular use cases. For example, MySQL, a popular database management system, has several storage engines, including InnoDB, MyISAM, and RocksDB in the MyRocks distribution. MongoDB allows switching between Wired Tiger, in-memory, and the now deprecated MMAP-V1 storage engines. Comparing databases. Your choice of database system may have long-term consequences. If there's a chance that a database is not a good fit because of performance problems, consistency issues, or operational challenges, it is better to find out about it earlier in the development cycle, since it can be non-trivial to migrate to a different system. In some cases, it may require substantial changes in the application code. Every database system has strengths and weaknesses. To reduce the risk of an expensive migration, you can invest some time before you decide on a specific database to build confidence in its ability to meet your application's needs. Trying to compare databases based on their components, for example, which storage engine they use, how the data is shared, replicated, and distributed, etc., their rank, an arbitrary popularity value assigned by consultancy agencies such as ThoughtWorks or database comparison websites such as DB Engines or Database of Databases, or implementation language, C++, Java, or Go, etc., can lead to invalid and premature conclusions. These methods can be used only for a high-level comparison and can be as coarse as choosing between HBase and SQLite. So even a superficial understanding of how each database works and what's inside it can help you land a more weighted conclusion. Every comparison should start by clearly defining the goal, because even the slightest bias may completely invalidate the entire investigation. If you're searching for a database that would be a good fit for the workloads you have or are planning to facilitate, the best thing you can do is to simulate these workloads against different database systems, measure the performance metrics that are important for you, and compare results. Some issues, especially when it comes to performance and scalability, start showing only after some time or as the capacity grows. To detect potential problems, it is best to have long-running tests and an environment that simulates the real-world production setup as closely as possible. Simulating real-world workloads not only helps you understand how the database performs, but also helps you learn how to operate, debug, and find out how friendly and helpful its community is. Database choice is always a combination of these factors, and performance often turns out not to be the most important aspect. It's usually much better to use a database that slowly saves the data than one that quickly loses it. To compare databases, it's helpful to understand the use case in great detail and define the current and anticipated variables, such as schema and record sizes, number of clients, types of queries and access patterns, rates of the read and write queries, expected changes in any of these variables. Knowing these variables can help to answer the following questions. Does the database support the required queries? Is this database able to handle the amount of data we're planning to store? How many read and write operations can a single node handle? How many nodes should the system have? How do we expand the cluster given the expected growth rate? What is the maintenance process? Having these questions answered, you can construct a test cluster and simulate your workloads. Most databases already have stress tools that can be used to reconstruct specific use cases. If there's no standard stress tool to generate realistic randomized workloads in the database ecosystem, it might be a red flag. If something prevents you from using default tools, you can try one of the existing general-purpose tools or implement one from scratch. If the tests show positive results, it may be helpful to familiarize yourself with the database code. Looking at the code, it is often useful to first understand the parts of the database, how to find the code for different components, and then navigate through those. Having even a rough idea about the database code base helps you better understand the log records it produces, its configuration parameters, and helps you find issues in the application that uses it, and even in the database code itself. It'd be great if we could use databases as black boxes and never have to take a look inside them. But the practice shows that sooner or later, a bug, an outage, a performance regression, or some other problem pops up, and it's better to be prepared for it. If you know and understand database internals, you can reduce business risks and improve chances for a quick recovery. One of the popular tools used for benchmarking, performance evaluation, and comparison is Yahoo Cloud Serving Benchmark, YCSB. YCSB offers a framework and a common set of workloads that can be applied to different data stores. Just like anything generic, this tool should be used with caution, since it's easy to make wrong conclusions. To make a fair comparison and make an educated decision, it is necessary to invest enough time to understand the real-world conditions under which the database has to perform and tailor benchmarks accordingly. TPCC Benchmark. The Transaction Processing Performance Council, TPC, has a set of benchmarks that database vendors use for comparing and advertising performance of their products. TPCC is an online transaction processing, OLTP, benchmark, a mixture of read-only and update transactions that simulate common application workloads. This benchmark concerns itself with the performance and correctness of executed concurrent transactions. The main performance indicator is throughput, the number of transactions the database system is able to process per minute. Executed transactions are required to preserve ACID properties and conform to the set of properties defined by the benchmark itself. This benchmark does not concentrate on any particular business segment, but provides an abstract set of actions important for most of the applications for which OLTP databases are suitable. It includes several tables and entities such as warehouses, stock, inventory, customers and orders, specifying table layouts, details of transactions that can be performed against these tables, the minimum number of rows per table, and data durability constraints. This doesn't mean that benchmarks can be used only to compare databases. Benchmarks can be useful to define and test details of the service level agreement, understanding system requirements, capacity planning, and more. Note: the service level agreement, or SLA, is a commitment by the service provider about the quality of provided services. Among other things, the SLA can include information about latency, throughput, jitter, and the number and frequency of failures. End note. The more knowledge you have about the database before using it, the more time you'll save when running it in production. Choosing a database is a long-term decision, and it's best to keep track of newly released versions, understand what exactly has changed and why, and have an upgrade strategy. New releases usually contain improvements and fixes for bugs and security issues, but may introduce new bugs, performance regressions, or unexpected behavior. So testing new versions before rolling them out is also critical. Checking how database implementers were handling upgrades previously might give you a good idea about what to expect in the future. Past smooth upgrades do not guarantee that future ones will be as smooth, but complicated upgrades in the past might be a sign that future ones won't be easy either. Understanding trade-offs. As users, we can see how databases behave under different conditions, but when working on databases, we have to make choices that influence this behavior directly. Designing a storage engine is definitely more complicated than just implementing a textbook data structure. There are many details and edge cases that are hard to get right from the start. We need to design the physical data layout and organize pointers, decide on the serialization format, understand how data is going to be garbage collected, how the storage engine fits into the semantics of the database system as a whole, figure out how to make it work in a concurrent environment, and finally, make sure we never lose any data under any circumstances. Not only are there many things to decide upon, but most of these decisions involve trade-offs. For example, if we save records in the order they were inserted into the database, we can store them quicker. But if we retrieve them in their lexicographical order, we have to resort them before returning results to the client. As you will see throughout this book, there are many different approaches to storage engine design, and every implementation has its own upsides and downsides. When looking at different storage engines, we discuss their benefits and shortcomings. If there was an absolutely optimal storage engine for every conceivable use case, everyone would just use it. But since it does not exist, we need to choose wisely based on the workloads and use cases we're trying to facilitate. There are many storage engines using all sorts of data structures implemented in different languages, ranging from low-level ones, such as C, to high-level ones, such as Java. All storage engines face the same challenges and constraints. To draw a parallel with city planning, it is possible to build a city for a specific population and choose to build up or build out. In both cases, the same number of people will fit into the city. But these approaches lead to radically different lifestyles. When building the city up, people live in apartments, and population density is likely to lead to more traffic in a smaller area. In a more spread-out city, people are more likely to live in houses, but commuting will require covering larger distances. Similarly, design decisions made by storage engine developers make them better suited for different things. Some are optimized for low read or write latency. Some try to maximize density, the amount of stored data per node, and some concentrate on operational simplicity. You can find complete algorithms that can be used for the implementation and other additional references in the chapter summaries. Listening to this book should make you well-equipped to work productively with these sources and give you a solid understanding of the existing alternatives to concepts described there. Chapter 1. Introduction and Overview. Database management systems can serve different purposes. Some are used primarily for temporary hot data. Some serve as a long-lived cold storage. Some allow complex analytical queries. Some only allow accessing values by the key. Some are optimized to store time series data, and some store large blobs efficiently. To understand differences and draw distinctions, we start with a short classification and overview, as this helps us to understand the scope of further discussions. Terminology can sometimes be ambiguous and hard to understand without a complete context. For example, distinctions between column and wide column stores that have little or nothing to do with each other, or how clustered and non-clustered indexes relate to index-organized tables. This chapter aims to disambiguate these terms and find their precise definitions. We start with an overview of database management system architecture and discuss system components and their responsibilities. After that, we discuss the distinctions among the database management systems in terms of storage medium and layout. These two groups do not present a full taxonomy of database management systems, and there are many other ways they're classified. For example, some sources group DBMSs into three major categories: online transaction processing, OLTP, databases. These handle a large number of user-facing requests and transactions. Queries are often predefined and short-lived. Online analytical processing, OLAP, databases. These handle complex aggregations. OLAP databases are often used for analytics and data warehousing and are capable of handling complex, long-running, ad hoc queries. Hybrid transactional and analytical processing, HTAP. These databases combine properties of both OTLP and OLAP stores. There are many other terms and classifications: key-value stores, relational databases, document-oriented stores, and graph databases. These concepts are not defined here, since the listener is assumed to have a high-level knowledge and understanding of their functionality. Because the concepts we discuss here are widely applicable and are used in most of the mentioned types of stores in some capacity, complete taxonomy is not necessary or important for further discussion. Since Part 1 of this book focuses on the storage and indexing structures, we need to understand the high-level data organization approaches and the relationship between the data and index files. Finally, in buffering, immutability, and ordering, we discuss three techniques widely used to develop efficient storage structures and how applying these techniques influences their design and implementation. DBMS architecture. There's no common blueprint for database management system design. Every database is built slightly differently, and component boundaries are somewhat hard to see and define. Even if these boundaries exist on paper, for example, in project documentation, in code, seemingly independent components may be coupled because of performance optimizations, handling edge cases, or architectural decisions. Sources that describe database management system architecture define components and relationships between them differently. The architecture presented in Figure 1-1, which can be found in the bonus materials, demonstrates some of the common themes in these representations. Database management systems use a client-server model, where database system instances, nodes, take the role of servers, and application instances take the role of clients. Client requests arrive through the transport subsystem. Requests come in the form of queries, most often expressed in some query language. The transport subsystem is also responsible for communication with other nodes in the database cluster. Upon receipt, the transport subsystem hands the query over to a query processor, which parses, interprets, and validates it. Later, access control checks are performed, as they can be done fully only after the query is interpreted. The parsed query is passed to the query optimizer, which first eliminates impossible and redundant parts of the query, and then attempts to find the most efficient way to execute it based on internal statistics, index cardinality, approximate intersection size, etc., and data placement, which nodes in the cluster hold the data and the costs associated with its transfer. The optimizer handles both relational operations required for query resolution, usually presented as a dependency tree, and optimizations such as index ordering, cardinality estimation, and choosing access methods. The query is usually presented in the form of an execution plan or query plan, a sequence of operations that have to be carried out for its results to be considered complete. Since the same query can be satisfied using different execution plans that can vary in efficiency, the optimizer picks the best available plan. The execution plan is handled by the execution engine, which collects the results of the execution of local and remote operations. Remote execution can involve writing and reading data to and from other nodes in the cluster and replication. Local queries, coming directly from clients or from other nodes, are executed by the storage engine. The storage engine has several components with dedicated responsibilities. Transaction manager. This manager schedules transactions and ensures they cannot leave the database in a logically inconsistent state. Lock manager. This manager locks on the database objects for the running transactions, ensuring that concurrent operations do not violate physical data integrity. Access methods, storage structures. These manage access and organizing data on disk. Access methods include heap files and storage structures, such as B-trees or LSM trees. Buffer manager. This manager caches data pages in memory. Recovery manager. This manager maintains the operation log and restoring the system state in case of a failure. Together, transaction and lock managers are responsible for concurrency control. They guarantee logical and physical data integrity while ensuring that concurrent operations are executed as efficiently as possible. Memory versus disk-based DBMS. Database systems store data in memory and on disk. In-memory database management systems, sometimes called main memory DBMS, store data primarily in memory and use the disk for recovery and logging. Disk-based DBMS hold most of the data on disk and use memory for caching disk contents or as a temporary storage. Both types of systems use the disk to a certain extent, but main memory databases store their contents almost exclusively in RAM. Accessing memory has been and remains several orders of magnitude faster than accessing disk, so it is compelling to use memory as the primary storage, and it becomes more economically feasible to do so as memory prices go down. Note, you can find a visualization and comparison of disk, memory access latencies, and many other relevant numbers over the years at people.eecs.berkeley.edu/tilde-rcs/research/interactive_latency.html. End note. However, RAM prices still remain high compared to persistent storage devices such as SSDs and HDDs. Main memory database systems are different from their disk-based counterparts, not only in terms of a primary storage medium, but also in which data structures, organization, and optimization techniques they use. Databases using memory as a primary data store do this mainly because of performance, comparatively low access costs, and access granularity. Programming for main memory is also significantly simpler than doing so for the disk. Operating systems abstract memory management and allow us to think in terms of allocating and freeing arbitrarily sized memory chunks. On disk, we have to manage data references, serialization formats, freed memory, and fragmentation manually. The main limiting factors on the growth of in-memory databases are RAM volatility, in other words, lack of durability, and costs. Since RAM contents are not persistent, software errors, crashes, hardware failures, and power outages can result in data loss. There are ways to ensure durability, such as uninterrupted power supplies and battery-backed RAM, but they require additional hardware resources and operational expertise. In practice, it all comes down to the fact that disks are easier to maintain and have significantly lower prices. The situation is likely to change as the availability and popularity of non-volatile memory, NVM, technologies grow. NVMe storage reduces or completely eliminates, depending on the exact technology, asymmetry between read and write latencies, further improves read and write performance, and allows byte-addressable access. Durability in memory-based stores. In-memory database systems maintain backups on disk to provide durability and prevent loss of the volatile data. Some databases store data exclusively in memory, without any durability guarantees, but we do not discuss them in the scope of this book. Before the operation can be considered complete, its results have to be written to a sequential log file. We discuss write-ahead logs in more detail in Recovery in Chapter 5. To avoid replaying complete log contents during startup or after a crash, in-memory stores maintain a backup copy. The backup copy is maintained as a sorted disk-based structure, and modifications to this structure are often asynchronous, decoupled from client requests, and applied in batches to reduce the number of I/O operations. During recovery, database contents can be restored from the backup and logs. Log records are usually applied to backup in batches. After the batch of log records is processed, backup holds a database snapshot for a specific point in time, and log contents up to this point can be discarded. This process is called checkpointing. It reduces recovery times by keeping the disk resident database most up to date with log entries without requiring clients to block until the backup is updated. Note: it is unfair to say that the in-memory database is the equivalent of an on-disk database with a huge page cache. Even though pages are cached in memory, serialization format and data layout incur additional overhead and do not permit the same degree of optimization that in-memory stores can achieve. Disk-based databases use specialized storage structures optimized for disk access. In memory, pointers can be followed comparatively quickly, and random memory access is significantly faster than the random disk access. Disk-based storage structures often have a form of wide and short trees, while memory-based implementations can choose from a larger pool of data structures and perform optimizations that would otherwise be impossible or difficult to implement on disk. Similarly, handling variable-sized data on disk requires special attention, while in memory it's often a matter of referencing the value with a pointer. For some use cases, it is reasonable to assume that an entire dataset is going to fit in memory. Some datasets are bounded by their real-world representations, such as student records for schools, customer records for corporations, or inventory in an online store. Each record takes up not more than a few KB, and their number is limited. Column versus row-oriented DBMS. Most database systems store a set of data records consisting of columns and rows in tables. Field is an intersection of a column and a row, a single value of some type. Fields belonging to the same column usually have the same data type. For example, if we define a table holding user records, all names would be of the same type and belong to the same column. A collection of values that belong logically to the same record, usually identified by the key, constitutes a row. One of the ways to classify databases is by how the data is stored on disk, row or column-wise. Tables can be partitioned either horizontally, storing values belonging to the same row together, or vertically, storing values belonging to the same column together. Figure 1-2 depicts this distinction. A shows the values partitioned column-wise, and B shows the values partitioned row-wise. Examples of row-oriented database management systems are abundant. MySQL, PostgreSQL, and most of the traditional relational databases. The two pioneer open-source column-oriented stores are MonetDB and CStore. CStore is an open-source predecessor to Vertica. Row-oriented data layout. Row-oriented database management systems store data in records or rows. Their layout is quite close to the tabular data representation, where every row has the same set of fields. For example, a row-oriented database can efficiently store user entries, holding names, birth dates, and phone numbers. ID, 10, name, John, birth date, 01 August 1981, phone number, 1111222333. ID, 20, name, Sam, birth date, 14 September 1988, phone number, 1555888999. ID, 30, name, Keith, birth date, 07 January 1984, phone number, 1333444555. This approach works well for cases where several fields constitute the record, name, birth date, and a phone number, uniquely identified by the key. In this example, a monotonically incremented number. All fields representing a single user record are often read together. When creating records, for example, when the user fills out a registration form, we write them together as well. At the same time, each field can be modified individually. Since row-oriented stores are most useful in scenarios when we have to access data by row, storing entire rows together improves spatial locality. Note, spatial locality is one of the principles of locality, stating that if a memory location is accessed, its nearby memory locations will be accessed in the near future. End note. Because data on a persistent medium, such as a disk, is typically accessed blockwise, in other words, a minimal unit of disk access is a block, a single block will contain data for all columns. This is great for cases when we'd like to access an entire user record, but makes queries accessing individual fields of multiple user records, for example, queries fetching only the phone numbers, more expensive, since data for the other fields will be paged in as well. Column-oriented data layout. Column-oriented database management systems partition data vertically, that is, by column, instead of storing it in rows. Here, values for the same column are stored contiguously on disk, as opposed to storing rows contiguously as in the previous example. For example, if we store historical stock market prices, price quotes are stored together. Storing values for different columns in separate files or file segments allows efficient queries by column, since they can be read in one pass rather than consuming entire rows and discarding data for columns that weren't queried. Column-oriented stores are a good fit for analytical workloads that compute aggregates, such as finding trends, computing average values, etc. Processing complex aggregates can be used in cases when logical records have multiple fields, but some of them, in this case price quotes, have different importance and are often consumed together. From a logical perspective, the data representing stock market price quotes can still be expressed as a table. ID 1, symbol Dow, date 08 August 2018, price 24,314.65. ID 2, symbol Dow, date 09 August 2018, price 24,136.16. ID 3, symbol S&P, date 08 August 2018, price 2,414.45. ID 4, symbol S&P, date 09 August 2018, price 2,232.32. However, the physical column-based database layout looks entirely different. Values belonging to the same row are stored closely together. Symbol 1 Dow, 2 Dow, 3 S&P, 4 S&P. Date 1-08 August 2018, 2-09 August 2018, 3-08 August 2018, 4-09 August 2018. Price 1 24,314.65, 2, 24,136.16, 3, 2,414.45, 4, 2,232.32. To reconstruct data tuples, which might be useful for joins, filtering, and multi-row aggregates, we need to preserve some metadata on the column level to identify which data points from other columns it is associated with. If you do this explicitly, each value will have to hold a key, which introduces duplication and increases the amount of stored data. Some column stores use implicit identifiers, virtual IDs, instead, and use the position of the value, in other words, its offset, to map it back to the related values. During the last several years, likely due to a rising demand to run complex analytical queries over growing datasets, we've seen many new column-oriented file formats, such as Apache Parquet, Apache ORC, RC File, as well as column-oriented stores, such as Apache Kudu, ClickHouse, and many others, ROI 12. Distinctions and optimizations. It is not sufficient to say that distinctions between row and column stores are only in the way the data is stored. Choosing the data layout is just one of the steps in a series of possible optimizations that columnar stores are targeting. Reading multiple values for the same column in one run significantly improves cache utilization and computational efficiency. On modern CPUs, vectorized instructions can be used to process multiple data points with a single CPU instruction. Note: vectorized instructions, or single instruction multiple data, SIMD, describes a class of CPU instructions that perform the same operation on multiple data points. End note. Storing values that have the same data type together, for example, numbers with other numbers, strings with other strings, offers a better compression ratio. We can use different compression algorithms depending on the data type and pick the most effective compression method for each case. To decide whether to use a column or a row-oriented store, you need to understand your access patterns. If the read data is consumed in records, that is, most or all of the columns are requested, and the workload consists mostly of point queries and range scans, the row-oriented approach is likely to yield better results. If scans span many rows, or compute aggregates over a subset of columns, it is worth considering a column-oriented approach. Wide column stores. Column-oriented databases should not be mixed up with wide column stores, such as Bigtable or HBase, where data is represented as a multi-dimensional map. Columns are grouped into column families, usually storing data of the same type, and inside each column family, data is stored row-wise. This layout is best for storing data retrieved by a key or a sequence of keys. A canonical example from the Bigtable paper is a web table. A web table stores snapshots of web page contents, their attributes, and the relations among them at a specific timestamp. Pages are identified by the reversed URL, and all attributes, such as page content and anchors, representing links between pages, are identified by the timestamps at which these snapshots were taken. In a simplified way, it can be represented as a nested map, as Figure 1-3 shows. Data is stored in a multi-dimensional sorted map with hierarchical indexes. We can locate the data related to a specific web page by its reversed URL and its contents or anchors by the timestamp. Each row is indexed by its row key. Related columns are grouped together in column families, contents and anchor in this example, which are stored on disk separately. Each column inside a column family is identified by the column key, which is a combination of the column family name and a qualifier, HTML, CNNSI.com, my.look.ca in this example. Column families store multiple versions of data by timestamp. This layout allows us to quickly locate the higher-level entries, web pages in this case, and their parameters, versions of content, and links to the other pages. While it is useful to understand the conceptual representation of wide column stores, their physical layout is somewhat different. A schematic representation of the data layout in column families is shown in Figure 1-4. Column families are stored separately, but in each column family, the data belonging to the same key is stored together. Data files and index files. The primary goal of a database system is to store data and to allow quick access to it. But how is the data organized? Why do we need a database management system and not just a bunch of files? How does file organization improve efficiency? Database systems do use files for storing the data, but instead of relying on file system hierarchies of directories and files for locating records, they compose files using implementation-specific formats. The main reasons to use specialized file organization over flat files are storage efficiency. Files are organized in a way that minimizes storage overhead per stored data record. Access efficiency. Records can be located in the smallest possible number of steps. Update efficiency. Record updates are performed in a way that minimizes the number of changes on disk. Database systems store data records, consisting of multiple fields, in tables, where each table is usually represented as a separate file. Each record in the table can be looked up using a search key. To locate a record, database systems use indexes, auxiliary data structures that allow it to efficiently locate data records without scanning an entire table on every access. Indexes are built using a subset of fields identifying the record. A database system usually separates data files and index files. Data files store data records, while index files store record metadata and use it to locate records in data files. Index files are typically smaller than the data files. Files are partitioned into pages, which typically have the size of a single or multiple disk blocks. Pages can be organized as sequences of records or as slotted pages. New records, insertions, and updates to the existing records are represented by key value pairs. Most modern storage systems do not delete data from pages explicitly. Instead, they use deletion markers, also called tombstones, which contain deletion metadata, such as a key and a timestamp. Space occupied by the records, shadowed by their updates or deletion markers, is reclaimed during garbage collection, which reads the pages, writes the live, that is, non-shadowed records to the new place, and discards the shadowed ones. Data files. Data files, sometimes called primary files, can be implemented as index-organized tables, IOT, heap-organized tables, heap files, or hash-organized tables, hashed files. Records in heap files are not required to follow any particular order, and most of the time they are placed in a write order. This way, no additional work or file reorganization is required when new pages are appended. Heap files require additional index structures, pointing to the locations where data records are stored, to make them searchable. In hashed files, records are stored in buckets, and the hash value of the key determines which bucket a record belongs to. Records in the bucket can be stored in append order or sorted by key to improve lookup speed. Index-organized tables, IOTs, store data records in the index itself. Since records are stored in key order, range scans in IOTs can be implemented by sequentially scanning its contents. Storing data records in the index allows us to reduce the number of disk seeks by at least one, since after traversing the index and locating the searched key, we do not have to address a separate file to find the associated data record. When records are stored in a separate file, index files hold data entries, uniquely identifying data records and containing enough information to locate them in the data file. For example, we can store file offsets, sometimes called row locators, locations of data records in the data file, or bucket IDs in the case of hash files. In index-organized tables, data entries hold actual data records. Index files. An index is a structure that organizes data records on disk in a way that facilitates efficient retrieval operations. Index files are organized as specialized structures that map keys to locations in data files where the records identified by these keys, in the case of heap files, or primary keys, in the case of index-organized tables, are stored. An index on a primary data file is called the primary index. However, in most cases, we can also assume that the primary index is built over a primary key or a set of keys identified as primary. All other indexes are called secondary. Secondary indexes can point directly to the data record or simply store its primary key. A pointer to a data record can hold an offset to a heap file or an index-organized table. Multiple secondary indexes can point to the same record, allowing a single data record to be identified by different fields and located through different indexes. While primary index files hold a unique entry per search key, secondary indexes may hold several entries per search key. If the order of data records follows the search key order, this index is called clustered, also known as clustering. Data records in the clustered case are usually stored in the same file or in a clustered file, where the key order is preserved. If the data is stored in a separate file, and its order does not follow the key order, the index is called non-clustered, sometimes called unclustered. Figure 1-5 shows the difference between the two approaches. A. Two indexes reference data entries directly from secondary index files. B. A secondary index goes through the indirection layer of a primary index to locate the data entries. Note: index-organized tables store information in index order and are clustered by definition. Primary indexes are most often clustered. Secondary indexes are non-clustered by definition, since they're used to facilitate access by keys other than the primary one. Clustered indexes can be both index-organized or have separate index and data files. Many database systems have an inherent and explicit primary key, a set of columns that uniquely identify the database record. In cases when the primary key is not specified, the storage engine can create an implicit primary key. For example, MySQL in ODB adds a new auto-increment column and fills in its values automatically. This terminology is used in different kinds of database systems. Relational database systems, such as MySQL and PostgreSQL, Dynamo-based NoSQL stores, such as Apache Cassandra and NREAC, and document stores, such as MongoDB. There can be some project-specific naming, but most often there's a clear mapping to this terminology. Primary index as an indirection. There are different opinions in the database community on whether data records should be referenced directly through file offset or via the primary key index. Note: the original post that has stirred up the discussion was controversial and one-sided, but you can refer to the presentation comparing MySQL and PostgreSQL index and storage formats, which references the original source as well. End note. Both approaches have their pros and cons, and are better discussed in the scope of a complete implementation. By referencing data directly, we can reduce the number of disk seeks, but have to pay a cost of updating the pointers whenever the record is updated, or relocating during a maintenance process. Using indirection in the form of a primary index allows us to reduce the cost of pointer updates, but has a higher cost on a read path. Updating just a couple of indexes might work if the workload mostly consists of reads. But this approach does not work well for write-heavy workloads with multiple indexes. To reduce the costs of pointer updates instead of payload offsets, some implementations use primary keys for indirection. For example, MySQL in ODB uses a primary index and performs two lookups, one in the secondary index and one in a primary index when performing a query. This adds an overhead of a primary index lookup instead of following the offset directly from the secondary index. Figure 1-6 shows how the two approaches are different. A. Two indexes reference data entries directly from secondary index files. B. A secondary index goes through the indirection layer of a primary index to locate the data entries. It is also possible to use a hybrid approach and store both data file offsets and primary keys. First, you check if the data offset is still valid and pay the extra cost of going through the primary key index if it has changed, updating the index file after finding a new offset. Buffering, immutability, and ordering. A storage engine is based on some data structure. However, these structures do not describe the semantics of caching, recovery, transactionality, and other things that storage engines add on top of them. In the next chapters, we will start the discussion with B-trees and try to understand why there are so many B-tree variants and why new database storage structures keep emerging. Storage structures have three common variables. They use buffering or avoid using it, use immutable or mutable files, and store values in order or out of order. Most of the distinctions and optimizations in storage structures discussed in this book are related to one of these three concepts. Buffering. This defines whether or not the storage structure chooses to collect a certain amount of data in memory before putting it on disk. Of course, every on-disk structure has to use buffering to some degree, since the smallest unit of data transfer to and from the disk is a block, and it is desirable to write full blocks. Here, we're talking about avoidable buffering, something storage engine implementers choose to do. One of the first optimizations we discuss in this book is adding in-memory buffers to B-tree nodes to amortize I/O costs. However, this is not the only way we can apply buffering. For example, two-component LSM trees, despite their similarity with B-trees, use buffering in an entirely different way and combine buffering with immutability. Mutability, or immutability. This defines whether or not the storage structure reads parts of the file, updates them, and writes the updated results at the same location in the file. Immutable structures are append-only. Once written, file contents are not modified. Instead, modifications are appended to the end of the file. There are other ways to implement immutability. One of them is copy-on-write, where the modified page, holding the updated version of the record, is written to the new location in the file instead of its original location. Often, the distinction between LSM and B-trees is drawn as immutable against in-place update storage. But there are structures, for example, BW-trees in Chapter 6, that are inspired by B-trees but are immutable. Ordering. This is defined as whether or not the data records are stored in the key order in the pages on disk. In other words, the keys that sort closely are stored in contiguous segments on disk. Ordering often defines whether or not we can efficiently scan the range of records, not only locate the individual data records. Storing data out of order, most often in insertion order, opens up for some write-time optimizations. For example, BitCask and WhiskKey store data records directly in append-only files. Of course, a brief discussion of these three concepts is not enough to show their power, and we'll continue this discussion throughout the rest of the book. Summary. In this chapter, we've discussed the architecture of a database management system and covered its primary components. To highlight the importance of disk-based structures and their difference from in-memory ones, we discussed memory and disk-based stores. We came to the conclusion that disk-based structures are important for both types of stores, but are used for different purposes. To understand how access patterns influence database system design, we discussed column and row-oriented database management system and the primary factors that set them apart from each other. To start a conversation about how the data is stored, we covered data and index files. Lastly, we introduced three core concepts: buffering, immutability, and ordering. We will use them throughout this book to highlight properties of the storage engines that use them. Further reading. If you'd like to learn more about the concepts mentioned in this chapter, you can refer to the following sources: Database Architecture, Hellerstein, Joseph M., Michael Stonebreaker, and James Hamilton, 2007, Architecture of a Database System, Foundations and Trends in Databases 1, No. 2, February. Column-Oriented DBMS, Abadi, Daniel, Peter Bontz, Stavros Horizopoulos, Stratos Idreos, and Samuel Madden, 2013, The Design and Implementation of Modern Column-Oriented Database Systems, In-Memory DBMS, Ferber, Franz, Alphonse Kemper, and Perd-Orke, Alphonse, 2017, Main Memory Database Systems. Chapter 2, B-Tree Basics. In the previous chapter, we separated storage structures in two groups, mutable and immutable ones, and identified immutability as one of the core concepts influencing their design and implementation. Most of the mutable storage structures use an in-place update mechanism. During insert, delete, or update operations,
we hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.